Hello everyone, namaste, welcome back to my channel. I know it's been quite a while. I should change my tag from fun, dark and mysterious to it's been quite a while. But anyways, I got sick and then we had, like, there are a lot of reasons, but let's just dive into for what we are here for, right? Also, if you're new here, hi, my name is Amisha Singh Chauhan, and if you're looking for something fun, dark and something really mysterious, then you're the right place. Do not forget to subscribe to my channel and also hit that bell icon so that every time I'm here with a new case to talk about, you'll get to know about it. Today we are going to talk about the case of Yara Gambirasio. Now, before I start with the case, a short disclaimer: this video is completely for educational purposes and I intend no disrespect or harm to any individual or being. Also, a small trigger warning: today we're going to talk about a little girl who gets abducted and gets murdered. So if you're someone who cannot take all of this, then it is absolutely fine if you choose to discontinue watching this video. But if you're interested to know what happened, you can skip the parts where we're talking about it. Also, I want to apologize in advance because this case took place in Italy, so there will be a lot of Italian names and I know I might butcher them. I mean, it's not even a doubt, I'm gonna butcher them. So let's just get started. Yara Gambirasio was a 13-year-old girl from a very small town in Italy, Brembi di Sopra, which is like north of Milan, and it just has a population of 8,000 people at the time. Now, what happened is that on 26th of November 2010, Yara Gambirasio, around 5:15 p.m., she left her house to go to the gymnasium, which was in a huge sports complex. She was learning to be a gymnastic, but on that day, she was not really going to the gym to, you know, do practice sessions and everything, but she was going to the gym to return back a stereo that she had borrowed from her instructor. So the family knew that she would be back home really soon. Now, what happened is that when she did not arrive back at her home around 7 p.m, her parents started getting worried because she was not someone who would, you know, she was not one of those type of teenagers who would go outside and, you know, get into their friends and would forget to inform their parents that they would be home late. So the mother especially, she got really worried about it. So she started calling her phone. And what happened was that all her calls were sent directly to the voicemail. Again, it was something that Yara would never do. So they waited for some time, and around 7:20 p.m. when she still did not come back and when they looked around and they couldn't find her, the father decided to call the police. The phone was directly put through public prosecutor's office in the center of provincial capital, Bergamo. Now, over there, the call was put through to the magistrate, who was Letizia Ruggeri. Now, Letizia Ruggeri was an expert in the field. She had dealt with mafias and she was a magistrate for past around like 15 years. So she knew what exactly the case was and how she has to deal with it. Moreover that, she was also a mother and she had a daughter herself. So she knew that every second was very important. What she did was that she immediately sent both state police and Carabinieri, which is like military police if I'm not wrong. So anyways, during the initial investigation, it was confirmed from the gym instructor that they had seen her doing some warm-up sessions in the gym before she left. Now, like I mentioned earlier, the gymnasium was in a huge sports complex. So there were like a lot of entrances and there were like a lot of exits. And for the investigators to track down all her movements would be quite difficult. Also, there were few people who said that they remembered that they saw her with two men in front of a red car outside the sports complex. But then nothing really came out of it and it was quite a dead end. Now, the last known contact with Yara Gambirasio was a text message that she had sent to her friend Martina, where she was confirming to meet with her the next following Sunday around 8 a.m. So this confirmed one thing, that she did not run away from her family, that she was not planning on running away from her family. Because if she would have had, because of, you know, various teenage reasons, then she wouldn't have agreed on meeting with her friend the following Sunday morning. Now, what Ruggeri did was, she immediately called in tracker dogs. Now, these tracker dogs, instead of going to the expected route that was to Yara's home, they went in a completely different direction, that was to a small hamlet near Mapello. Now, when Yara's phone was analyzed, her last presence was registered near Mapello as well. Now, in these cases, what happens is that the investigation initially starts from the family. The family was never under suspicion, to be honest, but they knew that they had to start there. I mean, they have to start somewhere, right? So they immediately started questioning the family. The father was an architect and the mother was a teacher, and they were quite a respected people in the town. And Yara was the second born. She had an older sister who was 15 years old and two younger brothers. Now, for the next part of investigation, Ruggeri put wiretaps on more than hundreds of phones. And they also traced down more than 15,000 phones that had passed through Mapello that day. Now, one of these phones was of a Moroccan man whose name is Mohammed Fikri. Mohammed Fikri was a foreigner in Italy. And in one of his phone conversations that was made in the last weeks of November, he could be heard saying, "Oh God, I did not kill her." Now, a side note over here, Italian was not his mother tongue. He was speaking in his own language. So this statement was apparently translated. Now, by the time this information got to the investigator, he was already on board bound for Tangiers, but he got arrested halfway through. Now, as soon as he got arrested, he was also excluded from the suspicion list. The reason was that he never really actually said, "Oh God, I didn't kill her." It was mistranslated. Also, there was this mattress that was found from the vessel which had blood stains on it, and initially the investigators thought that it was Yara's maybe, but the blood was actually extraneous to the investigation, so this entire angle was dropped out. And obviously the people did not like it, especially the localites over there. They wanted him to be the guilty party, you know, because he was a foreigner, and a lot of times people expect foreigners or someone who is alien or a stranger to do a crime. They don't expect someone from the neighborhood, or they don't want someone from the neighborhood to be the criminal. So anyways, this angle was dropped and they were back to square one. Now, when we talk about the family over here, the Gambirasios were very reserved from the very beginning, you know. And it is quite obvious. I mean, it's not easy for a family who does not know about the whereabouts of their daughter to go outside and directly talk with media. I mean, people do that, but they were not the types. But anyways, they knew that they had to go out and speak directly to the public. So they made a press appeal, and in their press appeal, you could literally see and hear their agony. The father was literally begging whoever did this to his daughter to just let the door open and let his daughter outside. And he promised that he would never ever look for the one who was behind all of this. He said that he does not want justice, he does not want revenge or vengeance or whatever it is. He just wants his daughter back, and if she gets back, he would never look for them. And he also released some pictures of her in hope that there might be some lead, but nothing really came out of it from as well. Now, for next 3 months, there was no improvement in the investigation. Now, exactly 3 months later, that is on 26th of February 2011, a middle-aged man, Ilario Scotti, who was playing around with his radio-controlled airplane in a small town, Cignolo di Sola. Again, I want to apologize if I butchered it. So this small town is basically like 10 kilometers away from Brembe di Sopra, which is like Yara Gambirasio's hometown. So this man was playing around with his remote controlled airplane, and it wasn't functioning the way he wanted it to be. So what he did was he got it back on earth. Now, he was in the woods surrounded by weeds, and when he bent down to get his airplane, he noticed that there were rags around. But then he initially ignored it, you know, because it's woods, you know, there are a lot of people who come and go and do a lot of things. So he initially ignored it. But then somehow he noticed a pair of shoes. And that is when it hit him that something was wrong, that something was terribly wrong. So what he did was he immediately called the police. Now, Letizia Ruggeri was coming back from one day skiing with her daughter, and when she got the phone call, she immediately arrived at the scene. Now, the moment she looked at the body, she knew that it was Yara Gambirasio. The body was already in an advanced state of decomposition, but the reason why she could identify was because of the clothes. They were the exact same clothing that Yara had worn when she stepped out of her house for the last time. That was a black bomber jacket and a Hello Kitty sweatshirt. Also, from around the scene, they got her iPod, house keys, and her phone battery and SIM cards. But there was no sign of her LG phone around. So anyways, the autopsy was done and it was confirmed that it indeed was Yara Gambirasio. In one of her press conferences, Ruggeri said that when she saw the body and when she realized that it was Yara Gambirasio, she was relieved because she knew that as a mother, the only thing worse than the death of a child is their disappearance. Now, during the autopsy, there were traces of lime found in her respiratory tract. Also, there were traces of jute found on her body, on her clothing. This indicated that the attacker, that the person behind this, was involved in building business. Also, there was no sign of rape, but her bra was unhooked. There were a lot of injuries that were inflicted from a sharp weapon, and after she was attacked and injured multiple times, she was left abandoned and she died because of exposure. Now, initially, they could retrieve two DNA samples, but when the authorities tried to compare it with whatever samples they had in record, it did not match any of them. But 2 months later, Ruggeri got a phone call from a laboratory and she was informed that there was a DNA that was found on her underwear, as in on Yara's underwear. Though a side note over here, when I was doing my research, a lot of articles, which were in Italian by the way, some articles said that this DNA was found on her underwear, some said that it was found on the phone's battery or SIM card. But anyways, the baseline is that they found a DNA sample and this sample was of a male. So they had their suspect and they named their suspect as Ignoto 1, which translates to unknown male number 1. So now they had something, I mean they had a DNA sample, right? But the problem was that back in the days, I don't know about now, but back in the days they did not have a fully developed DNA system. Like, you know, in a lot of countries they have DNAs of all of their citizens, so it is quite easy to just correspond and match. But at the time they did not have that kind of a system. So now what Ruggeri did was she distributed the duties among various forces. The police were responsible for taking DNA samples of family, friends, school friends, you know, people who were present in the gym or in the sports complex or anyone who Yara knew. And the Carabinieri, they concentrated on phone records. So what they were doing was they were cross-referencing any phone that was present on the day, that is on 26th of November 2010 at Brembe di Sopra and as well as in Cinolo di Sola. Then these phones were tracked down, their owner's DNA sample was taken. Now the cost of machinery and manpower that was invested in all of this was huge, was immense. And this investigation would go on to become one of the most biggest and expensive manhunts in the history of Italy. Now Yara Gambirasio's funeral was conducted on May of 2011 and it was conducted in the very same sports hall where she was last seen alive. Her tombstone does not have any date, it just has her signature. Now, by the time of her funeral, the investigators had accumulated more than thousands of DNA samples, but unfortunately, it did not match with Ignoto 1. Now, Ruggeri knew one thing, that most of the time, when a criminal drops off a dead body, of the victim's body, they drop it off at a place which they are familiar with. So there was this nightclub very close to where Yara's body was found. Its name is Sabi Mobili and this nightclub quite had a reputation of violence. Now, thankfully and fortunately for the investigators and Ruggeri's team, it was memberships only. So that meant that it was very easy for them to track down each and every member and get their DNA samples so that they could just, you know, use it as reference with Ignoto 1. Now that is when they had their first break. There was this man, Damiano Guerinoni, whose DNA was very similar to Ignoto 1. It did not match, but it was very similar to Ignoto 1. Also, when Damiano was interrogated, it came out that on the day of Yara's disappearance, he was in South America. So there was no possibility that it was his DNA. But the geneticists, the experts, they were sure, they were convinced that whoever Ignoto 1 was, he was related to Damiano Guerinoni. So now what the investigators started doing was that they started investigating his family. And then came another sharp twist in the case. Damiano Guerinoni's mother, Aurora Zani, actually worked in Gambirasio's household for more than 10 years. But at the time of Yara's disappearance, she was not really working, but she had like a very close relationship with the Gambirasios. And now she was at the center of investigation, which really bothered her. She really adored the girl and her death made her very upset. And now that she was at the center of the entire investigation, bothered her more. Now Ruggeri followed them around, pressed and drilled them to find out any lead, to find out anything so as to they could get closer to Ignoto 1. But unfortunately, they got nothing out of it. And reluctantly, Ruggeri had to drop this entire angle and accept that this was all nothing but a crazy, crazy coincidence. Now, for the next couple of months, her team sat down and they started recreating entire Damiano Guerinoni's family tree, which went as far as 1815, and the other branches of the tree went as far as 1716. Now, the roots of this family was from a very small village named Gorno, which is like 45 minutes drive north of Bermago itself. Now, with Damiano's family, the thing was that he was the last surviving male and his DNA did not match. But Damiano's father actually had a brother, Giuseppe Guerinoni, and Giuseppe Guerinoni died in 1999. So what the investigators did was they visited his widow, and fortunately they were able to get two of his DNA samples from two stamps. Now, one of these stamps was to validate his driving license and the other one was for a postcard. Now, when this DNA sample was tested, it was found out, it was confirmed that Giuseppe was 100% the father of Ignoto 1. So now we think that, boom, the case is solved. We just need to get the son, right? He had three kids, two of them were sons, and we know from the very beginning that Ignoto 1 is a male. So they went ahead and they tested out his two sons and they were not a match. They did not match with Ignoto 1. So where do we start? We were back at square one. So if Giuseppe's two sons were not Ignoto 1, that meant one thing, that he had another son. Another son that nobody knew about, another son who was illegitimate. So now they had to find this woman who was like middle-aged or old and who had an affair with Giuseppe 30 to 40 years ago, and then she had his son, and this son later would go on murdering Chiara Gambirasio. So this was basically an investigation within an investigation. Now, after a lot of struggle, the investigators found out that every year from 1960 onwards, he would go to south of Milan to this particular spa resort named Celestone alone without his wife. So there was a lot of chances that he would have had, you know, little hanky-panky with some woman over there. So what the investigators did was that they started going through the records and they started to contact all these women, and their DNA samples were taken, but it did not match with Ignoto 1. They also went through a lot of orphanages around the area and fallen women houses, but again, nothing came out of it. So that implied that this woman who was having an affair with Giuseppe was basically hiding behind the doors of marriage. Because if she would have been a single mother, then they would have got her. So now they started looking and going around the town and finding out that who was the woman that Giuseppe was having an affair with. Which was a tough thing to do because the town was very small and the people were very religious and loyal, and they wouldn't talk about infidelities or extramarital affairs so easily. So basically nobody was opening their mouth. Now, until this point, the entire case was being solved scientifically, you know, very cutting edge types. But it was an old fashioned detective who broke the case open. And I'm talking about Marshal Giovanni Moserino, who was Ruggeri's right hand man. Now, he was that kind of a detective which we would see in a lot of crime shows, you know, the one who sits with a huge table and has like a lot of pictures, newspaper clippings and stuff like that. And he literally, for the past 4 years, because of Chiara Gambirasio's case, he did not take a single day leave. Now, during his investigation, he found out that during 1960s and 70s, Giuseppe was working as a public bus driver. And almost every day, he would drive around 60 to 70 women from the village to nearby textile factories. So there was a lot of chances and opportunities for him to interact with these women and, you know, do things. Also, when he was interacting with Giuseppe's co-drivers, one of the drivers described Giuseppe as a man with a capital M, indicating that he was a womanizer. But the thing was that nobody was pointing out the name. But it wasn't until June of 2014 that Marshal Moserino finally got a name from one of his sources that everyone was looking for. It was Esther Arzufi. Esther Arzufi was Giuseppe's neighbor during the 1960s in Ponselva. She left Ponselva in 1970s, but she continued to have her affair with Giuseppe. And in autumn of 1970, she gave birth to twins. One was a girl and the other one was a boy. This boy was 42 years old, Massimo Giuseppe Bossetti. Yes, Giuseppe, his middle name came from his biological father. Now, Ruggeri's team immediately tested out Esther's DNA and they found out that there was a very basic minor error that had been made back in July of 2012. So what happened was that back in 2012, Esther's DNA sample was also taken and tested. But instead of comparing the DNA sample with Ignoto 1, it was compared with Yara's. Now, because of this, they couldn't find any link between Ignoto 1 and Esther. If they would have had, then the case would have solved much earlier in 2012 only. So anyways, they tested her DNA again and it was confirmed that Esther Arzofi was indeed Ignoto 1's biological mother. Now, I would like to add something over here. Meanwhile, Ruggeri's team was investigating the entire Giuseppe thing. The family hired their own expert. And this expert, after a lot of struggle, finally got permission to extract DNA sample from Giuseppe's remains. And when this sample was tested, it was also confirmed over there that Giuseppe was definitely 100% the biological father of Ignoto 1. So now you know that two different teams got the same DNA and they came to the very same conclusion that Giuseppe was Ignoto 1's father. Now back to Massimo Bozzetti. He was a 42-year-old man with a wife and three children. He was living in Mapello, the hamlet near Yara's hometown where her phone's last signal was registered. Now initially, Ruggeri wanted to study him. She wanted to investigate much deeper, but she knew that if this news broke out in the public, then he would try to run away and they might lose him. So she immediately got into it. On 15th of June 2014, Ruggeri set up a fake roadblock breath analyzing drivers. And Massimo Bozzetti was in his car with his family and he was joking around. He was like, ha ha ha, I'm not drunk, I'm gonna get past this. But he did not know that there was this entire plan that was set up for him. So when the police officers stopped Massimo, they pretended that the machine was not working the first time. So this way they got another machine and they got two different samples, two DNA samples to test it. They sent it for overnight testing and within a couple of hours, it was confirmed that Ignoto 1 was Massimo Bozzetti. It was a definite confirmed match. Now, according to one geneticist, the chance of a random match between Ignoto 1 and Massimo Bozzetti was 2 into 10 raised to the power negative 27. Now, he was arrested on 16th of June 2014. Investigators discovered plenty of circumstantial evidences. Bozzetti had frequently hung around Yara's house. He would go around her gymnasium, around the sports complex, and a lot of times he would spend hours and hours sitting across the street in this particular pizzeria. Also, his internet searches were troubling. He would use search engines which implied a compulsion for pubescent girls. Also, the investigators, when they analyzed his phone, they found out that on the day of Yara's disappearance, his phone was present in Brembe di Sopra, but it was switched off around 5:45 p.m. and then it was later switched on around 7:34 a.m. the next morning. Now, Massimo Bozzetti from the very beginning claimed that he was innocent. Obviously, when this news broke out, Giuseppe's widow and Massimo Bozzetti's father, they completely broke down. I mean, they found out, like Giuseppe's widow found out that her husband was cheating on her and he had various other kids out of their marriage. And with Massimo Bozzetti's father, he found out that his kids were not really his kids and his wife was having affairs. Now, let's talk about the court proceedings over here. The defense from the very beginning tried to portray Massimo as a family man. But as soon as his name came out in news, there were two people who came out and claimed that they were having an affair with his wife. But anyways, the defense was focusing on a gym instructor. Now, this gym instructor, Sylvia Brenner, her bloodstains were found on Yara's jacket. Also, according to Sylvia Brenner's father, the day Yara got disappeared, Sylvia was crying the whole night. And when she was asked why she was doing so, she did not tell anyone the reason behind it. And when she was questioned by the investigators as to why did she delete some of the messages that she had sent to her brother around the time of Yara's disappearance, she said that she cannot remember because it was irrelevant. The defense also claimed that Ignoto 1's DNA was taken long back, like really long back. So there could have been a chance of error. He also stated that the DNA evidence claims his presence but not his responsibility. I know it just does not make sense to me either, because if he was present and if he's not the one who's responsible for this, then that means there was another man or there were other men. And how come these men or women's DNA were not found on her body? And if he knows something, then he has a lot to answer. But anyways, he was found guilty, and on 1st of July 2016, he was given life imprisonment, which was confirmed on 12th of October 2018. Though, what happened was that the defense appealed for a revision of the DNA evidence in 2019, which was accepted in January of 2021. That means this year. Now, here we come to the end of this video. I would like to add something over here, that her legacy continues, the Gambirasio family, in her remembrance. They started this gymnastic award. Now, there's really not a lot to discuss about this case. It's solved. And the thing is that even if it is solved, there's no happy ending to it. I mean, the happy ending would have been, you know, finding out and getting her back home alive. But yes, I mean, in my opinion, I feel that Massimo Bozzetti is the one, is the criminal, is the culprit behind this. Because see, whatever evidence I found on internet, whatever evidence we have right now, when I study them, this is what my conclusion is, this is what my opinion is, that he is the one. And I'm not saying, I mean, there is definitely a possibility that he is just not the one behind this. He could have other perpetrators as well. If that is so, then he should definitely name them, and investigation would definitely happen, obviously. So that is there. But yeah, my opinion is that. I would love to know yours. Put them in the comment section. Now, the second thing that I want to talk about over here was how proud I am of Ruggeri. I mean, she, the entire time, the entire investigation, it took a lot of years. There were so many people who were investigated. There were so many DNA samples that were taken. The entire investigation was so expensive, literally. And a lot of times people, they did not shy away from throwing personal attacks. In fact, especially politicians, you know, they would make sexist comments on her because she was a woman. A lot of times people commented that she's just a woman and a woman cannot solve such a complex case. But then she definitely solved it. She had the dedication, she had the expertise, she had the knowledge and the skills that was required. She did not lose hope. She was a mother herself and she knew how important it was for the family to find about Yara Gambirasio and to find the person behind it all. And she did it. And I feel so proud of her. And the thing is that there are so many cases out there in the world. There is John Merritt Ramsey's case. Remember in John Merritt Ramsey's case, there's this one unknown DNA. And we don't know whose it is. I mean, there are a lot of theories. Some believe it is X, Y, Z's, whatever. Then we have the Talwar's case here in India. And I feel that only if the police forces in these respective cases and all of these cases, only if they showed the very same dedication and hard work, then I feel the case would have been solved. I mean, I feel that from the day one of a crime, if the investigators maintain a momentum, maintain a uniformity and continuity, then they would definitely come to a certain conclusion. But if that momentum breaks, then the case is doomed. It just keeps on dragging for years and years and then ends up being a cold case. So I just hope that, you know, all of the cases in the world, I mean, it's too much to ask for, but I really hope that people get identified and such cases get solved and justice is served to the family and the victim. But yeah, that's all for the day. I really hope for, I mean, it's a, like I said, it's a lot to ask. I would love to know your opinions, your views on it. Do you think Massimo is to be blamed or do you think he's a scapegoat? I would love to know your opinions. And if you have any suggestions, if you have any views, anything you want to talk about, put them in the comment section or you could directly message me on my Instagram. Also, if you found this video informative, then do hit the like button and subscribe if you haven't. It keeps me motivated. And most importantly, please take care of yourself. Be positive, try to be healthy, be happy, be hopeful, and take care of people around you. Bye-bye, take care.